Manawatu Toyota Daybreaker Rally, surely the toughest rally in the three-sport championship. And for 1994, the final round, 17 stages from midnight till 6:30 p.m. Starting in the dark in Palmerston North, and first on the road, defending champ Joe McAndrew.
Depends how the roads really are and how it all shapes up out there. It's a long rally, a lot of things can happen between a lot of cars, and yeah, it's a long day.
You've lost the championship on this rally before. Is that in the back of your mind?
Yeah, it sure is. But definitely, this is the final. I'm in the same position exactly where I was years ago. I'm not going to let it go this time. We're just going to have to try our hardest and got a real good grip on it and just get it to the end.
2 weeks earlier in Hamilton, Escort driver Brian Stokes had blasted the field until the end of the rally, only just being beaten by McAndrew.
Oh, we'll be doing our own thing as usual, and hopefully that's charging. Yeah, it's certainly a long event. You've got to keep that in mind too. But if you want to win the championship and win the rally, you've got to go flat stick.
Group N, with only 1 point separating Andrew Grant, Rhys Jones, and Greg Graham. First home would take the championship, while Brian Watkin could hope for a good result at the end of the season.
I think I can cope with the pressure. Yeah, we're going to start out hard from the word go. As you probably know, whoever wins Group N in this one's going to win the national championship, so there's a lot at stake. But no, I think the pressure, I think I can cope with it. It'll just make us go that little bit harder.
Well, over the years, I've actually enjoyed this rally. It's good fun, good roads. But I think once you get past the nighttime stuff, through to this morning, it's about 9 o'clock. Tomorrow morning, it'll be all right. That's the hardest part of the rally, I think.
It'll be hard out all day, so or all night, whatever it is. But yeah, there's no sitting back and waiting for the other guys to make a mistake. You've just got to go for it. Survival of the fittest, yeah.
And as Joe McAndrew led away the field, our man, Chucky Shearer, was gearing up for a night of action.
Yeah, that's right, Clint. Over the next 18 hours or so, I'll be with the Rallyworks team here and the service crew, hopefully making sure that the car is going to go from start to finish. Toby, what's the first thing I need to do?
The first thing, Chuck, is you're going to put on this pair of overalls.
Sounds like a good idea. Yeah.
And this jacket. Getting warm with a cold night time.
A very sexy jacket. I'll catch up with you guys down the road.
McAndrew took the lead from stage one. He was first on the road, so not plagued by the dust that was slowing those behind. To make things worse, the organisers wouldn't allow the normal two-minute gap for the top-seater drivers. Stokes was the first to suffer, rolling on his side, but continuing thanks to the spectators who pushed him back. However, he was not able to match McAndrew in these conditions. Andrew Grant came next and was off at the same corner. Then here with Greg Graham, we see Rhys Jones in the same ditch. Graham looks like the early favourite for Group N honours, but his misfortune was just a few kilometres down the road. And that was an early end to the season for Greg Graham and co-driver Jim Robb, both thankful that the car didn't actually roll. Jeff Argyle has bought the Thexton Nissan Pulsar, and he was right on the pace in this car, which he hopes will give him more of a chance at an outright win in 1995. Bruce Herbert was second here in 93, hoped to repeat that with his Group N Plus Lancer. Like many drivers not competing for championship points, he has boosted the engine power of his car. And Murray O'Neill, who for this weekend had Chuck along to help or hinder in the service crew.
Well, it's about 25 past 4 in the morning. We're all a little bit pensive because we saw a number 20 car goes past, but here's our car, number 18, ready for service stop number 4. I've got no idea what's happening in the race. All I know is that we're making it from service stop to service spot in time. To service the car here. It's really good, actually. I'm quite surprised at how exciting the race behind the race is. It's good fun. I'm going to go do the tyres.
Got any of that leak, Mars leaks.
Yeah. All right, Murray, quarter of the way through the rally now. How's it feeling and what's sort of going on with the car and yourself?
Well, we didn't have a particularly good start. You know, a few little problems which sort of had us worried early on. Apart from that, the old co-driver, she's a little bit sick, and she's good though. She just puts the window down and says, keep going, you know, not a problem. I'm going, sure you're all right. You know, you try not to look off, you know, away from the road because you're meant to be doing a job on the right hand side of the car. But you know, she did well, and we got out of that stage, and now we've just got, you know, just in, the problems are sort of accumulating. The heat from the gearbox is causing the engine to overheat slightly, and it just all starts to snowball. So we've just got to just keep an eye on it, and just if we have to pull it back a bit, we'll do that. You know, just, it's an endurance event.
Here at Mongaweka, McAndrew relaxes with the knowledge that the car is in good hands, and he has the measure of Stokes.
Yeah, we've got a good break at the rally at the moment. I don't know really what Brian's been doing. We had a spin in the last one, and we thought we would have come out about equal, or he would have had some time on us, but we still took time off us, so we're pretty pleased how it's going so far.
Stokes' co-driver, Jeff Judd, has to wear an extra jacket after that stage one roll, which smashed his window.
Well, actually, it happened quite early on, about 10 corners into the first stage, and the dust was really thick, and it was a tightening right-hander, and actually put the car up on two wheels, and I thought it would come down, but it actually rolled just about right over and stopped. Luckily, there were some spectators there, and they came along and pushed us back on our wheels, and away we went.
Brian Watkin took over the Group N lead after Andrew Grant crashed out on stage four. While Bruce Herbert trailed him by 10 seconds, it was the start of a battle which would last all day long.
I seem to have a few problems with the car at the moment. Some the rear subframe and differential problems, eh? So it's a matter of endurance from now on. I don't sound like I know what I'm talking about, but I'm just mimicking what these guys have said.
Actually, the car's diff mounts have broken off the rear subframe, Chuck. The team doing a temporary repair, which they hope would last till tie happy. On the road, McAndrew was playing road sweeper, clearing the gravel off for the car's following, which sometimes caused him problems. But the lead was never in doubt, and at the end of the night, he was 3.5 minutes in front. Will be Chuck Shearer. He was sort of in the darkness on the Daybreaker rally in the Manawatu. It's time to go back now as the rally heads into daylight, and Chuck starts to think he knows something about cars. Well, especially for their crew, that could be dangerous. Daybreak and relief for the crews. The roads open out as the rally heads for Wairuru via stage 7, a tight road north of Taihape with huge drops off the side. But it's no problem for McAndrew, who has an amazing ability to throw this large car around on the road. Stokes takes a wider line in, but can't swing the car around. Rhys Jones has conceded the Group N lead to Watkin, because with Greg Graham and Andrew Grant out, he is now the 1994 Group N champion and doesn't need any more points from this rally. Watkin has the Subaru flying for the first time this season and is obviously enjoying his first competitive run in the car. Herbert started to charge, posting third fastest on this stage and now only 8 seconds away from Watkin. Robert Lester has come back in these final rallies with a Mitsubishi, which he will campaign in the 1995 championship. The 1993 junior champion was having a great battle with Jason Gardner, this year's Rothmans Junior Scholarship winner, which would see both drivers finish in the top five. Brian Green had renewed confidence after finishing the Hamilton rally in the Mazda. He's won this rally more often than any other driver and was seventh overall here. And Orsam Willor, also in the top 10, improving there's still life left in a Group N legacy.
All right, 7 o'clock in the morning, we're in Taihape. A little bit of problem with the car. We saw the old guys doing the repairs underneath by the diff. They've stopped here at the mobile service station for a quick stop, do a bit of welding, and hopefully the boys are able to get it sorted out and finish off. We're only a third of the way through the rally, so still got a long way to go, and I'm starting to feel a pace.
Now, we're not sure if Chuck actually helped, although we did see him check the tyre pressure. And Murray was soon on his way. Well, for a while anyway. Maybe a little too much air in the rear tyres there, Chuck. At Wairuru, McAndrew had a 3-minute lead, but Stokes had started the charge. He took 20 seconds off the Subaru, and the Ford fans could see the chance of another legendary Stokes charge to the lead. And speaking of legends, this is the old Neil Allport RX7, which blitz rallies in New Zealand in the mid-80s. Now fully restored and in the hands of Rob Murray, it was entertaining to watch. But seated in front of the Mitsubishi of Jason Gardner, the older car was a huge problem. Gardner caught the Mazda's dust on every stage, which just shows how fast these new generation cars are. The rally headed east to the Gentle Annie stage, which starts in the high tussock lands at the head of the Rangitiki River. The road was heavily metalled, so McAndrew once again played road sweeper, and it's this style of open flowing road which best suits the powerful Group A cars. Stokes took full advantage of the dust-free conditions to beat McAndrew by 19 seconds, showing again that he could still challenge McAndrew. Although with only 6 stages to go, he would have to hope that McAndrew would have a problem. Watkin lost his 3rd place to Herbert here, but Rhys Jones had retired with electrical problems on stage 8, so the Castrol Subaru had a clear lead in Group N. Herbert had been as low as 8th, so 3rd at this stage was a great comeback. He posted 3rd fastest time through here, but was still 1 minute slower than Stokes. Next came Will Orr, 10 seconds slower than Herbert, but beating Watkin by 1 second. Stage 12, and McAndrew had to charge to keep Stokes at a safe distance. But Stokes was putting in a superhuman effort. The car had cut out before the start, so he had to start 1 minute behind Will Orr, and here was only 11 seconds behind. But this time, Stokes' luck was about to run out at very high speed. Disappointed co-driver Jeff Judd hangs out the OK sign. But the car was not OK, and Stokes' hand was badly cut when the car rolled on it. So that was the end of the challenge. McAndrew had enough points without this rally to claim the 1994 three-sport New Zealand Rally Championship. Back-to-back wins, and with maximum points from 5 wins in 5 rallies. Bruce Herbert was now 2nd overall, same as in 1993, and able to keep clear of Brian Watkin. Watkin was happy to end the season with the Group N win, and the scene is set for a big battle in this class in 1995. And what about the Rallyworks team with Chuck and the crew? Well, here on stage 15, Murray O'Neill was flying, but the car was in a ditch by stage 16.
All right. quite well. There's always hard luck stories in sport, but as sporting experiences go, this is going to be one of the most bizarre experiences I've ever had. This is, I think, my 37th hour without sleep, and kind of in the end, it all came down for nothing, really, eh? Which is kind of crazy. You spend all this work, I guess that's the way it's going. I'm not too disappointed because we started out quite badly, but it looked like we're going to sort of do all right. We kind of managed to get through stages, but that's just the way things go. Tell me, mate, as the engineering man, I mean, how is it? Like, do you wish you had bigger parts, bigger budgets, you know, more tools, more everything? I mean, how would that make your job?
Yeah, well, I think it would definitely help. It sort of showed that if we had the equipment, we'd be up there, you
right.
know. But
that's how it goes.
Yeah, it comes down to dollars, unfortunately.
This is a man, I don't know. Are you responsible? I'm not sure. Can you blame it on something else? Second last days to go, put it in the ditch, couldn't get it out. I mean, would you come back and do it all next weekend?
Well, we've put this question to ourselves before because we've been in this situation before and we've been back here again doing it. I mean,
yeah.
God knows why. The Daybreaker was just one of those rallies where it's just a big challenge and you've just got to take it up.
Yeah.
And you know that now.
Yeah.
You know? You know, we got the tough break, you know, then in that stage and call it drive error, what you will, you know. But, We proved a point over this weekend, I think.
It's got many years of good fast times. I mean, you know, top 10 and stuff. As the manager of the team, I mean, you know, what do you do from here? This is the last one for this year. What happens next year?
Oh, we're thinking about a new car for next year, looking for a major sponsor. We want to go to the Nationals. We proved ourselves today in this type of environment. We're doing it well. But, yeah, it comes down to money once again. It comes down to the contacts and... Yeah, the drive.
I tell you what, mate, if you're looking for a new team, you can start looking for a new crew right now. I think this is my one and only Dawn Breaker Rally, Daybreaker Rally. I've had it.